everyone. Welcome to Protective Diet Education class number 125. And tonight's lesson is all about essential kitchen tools for operating a protective diet plant-based kitchen. So these are the tools just getting started that you can't live without. It would be really hard to produce great recipes without these essential kitchen tools. We're going to be having a class coming up really soon. It might be next week. I'm going to see if I can rearrange a few classes and do that to provide you with tools that you want to put on your wish list, tools that will make life easier in the kitchen. But these tonight that I'm going to cover are your basics. So if you're helping someone set up a kitchen, a PD kitchen, or you're just getting started yourself in the kitchen, if you're a first-time chef or cook, you're going to love this class because it's going to give you the basics. Because I did a kitchen tools class previous to this much earlier on in the start of PD Ed, and I showed you exactly every single gadget that I had in my kitchen, and for some people that's overwhelming. So I want to show you what is necessary and essential just to make all of the basic recipes on protective diet. Once in a while we add in a new gadget or a new tool, and when I do that I always make sure that you can use one of these essential tools to do the same exact recipe. It might take you a little longer, it might be something that you have to do in a different style, but I'll direct you exactly through it to be able to create the recipe. But there's a few tools that make things better. But the ones we're covering tonight are essential. So make a list, and if you're cleaning out your kitchen, maybe you have a lot of items that are just getting in the way, and you want to put these tools in really handy, quick grab spots in the kitchen, because these are the tools that I use on a daily basis or most frequently. So if you have any questions, I want you to ask them in all caps. Jerry's going to read them off to me. They can be unrelated questions as well. This is one of your hours of the week. We're together 2.5 hours a week live that you can interact and ask me any of your personal questions. So always feel free to chime in, write it in all caps, and Jerry will be sure I get it. And on application, on recipes, these questions can be on anything. So we are going to get started with my number one kitchen tool. And that would be my Blendtec blender. This is my high-speed blender. Now, a lot of people, they'll make the recipes, the dips and sauces using Ninja, and they think that's a high-speed blender, or a classic blender, and they're just not coming out tasting that great, or the texture's not that great. I would recommend investing in a high-speed blender. If you already have a Vitamix, that's fantastic. Hang on to that. You don't need to get a Blendtec on top of it. Vitamix and Blendtec are the two high-speed blenders on the market, and a lot of people look at them and they're like, oh my gosh, yes, go ahead.
In the chat, they're all going crazy because they love their Blendtec blenders.
Okay, awesome, yeah. It makes a huge difference in the kitchen, especially if you're practicing a protective diet, because we're eating a whole food plant-based diet, so we use a lot of sauces, dips, dressings to make our whole plant-based foods. The staples that we use all the time, fantastic. So I want you to have the tool that's gonna make these sauces awesome, blend of chia seeds to thicken your dressings, and we can blend our own flours. It's just great if you want to do that. And I use it daily, without a doubt. And most people do, I'm sure they're saying that in the chat right now. So the Blendtec, I recommend the refurbished Blendtec. It's about $279 and free shipping through Blendtec with our link. You want to ask for or order the 4-side jar. This is designed to blend protective diet recipes perfectly. The wild side jar is good if you're into making double batches. It's not going to blend the ingredients so easily. With the Blendtec, there's no tamper. So we always load the blender, wet ingredients. So say you're making the guac famole. You're gonna put the lime juice in first. Then you're gonna put the spinach leaves in. Then you're gonna put the chickpeas on top. So if you get the idea, you're layering lightest to heaviest. So those chickpeas are gonna actually push the spinach and the lime juice down and fall up and down on themselves and blend. There's no tamper needed like with the Vitamix. So if you layered it the other way, you're going to have a hard time with blends. And just a tip on this blender, if you already have it and you're struggling with it, I only blend on high. I don't use any of the presets. The presets on this blender are designed to for like, say, a dip recipe. They're not blending a whole brick of tofu like we are. They're blending sour cream and mayonnaise with a packet of ranch dressing. So they're not blending what we're blending. We're blending harder ingredients. We're blending beans into purees. So this is not something like chickpeas, it's a little firmer. This is not something that this blender was designed to do. It wasn't designed for a plant-based diet. It was designed for a standard diet where they're making smoothies and blending sour cream into a salad dressing or a dip, not a brick of tofu. So always use the arrows, or some of you have a dial that goes across on the BlendTec. There's a few different models. Always take it to high. Just let it rip, I always say, and let it blend till it's nice and smooth. Now, if you're thinking, oh my gosh, Julie, what are you talking about? This blender is almost $300. That's ridiculous. I'm not spending that to do a protective diet. I want to tell you, go the first couple months. It should take you 2 months, and you should be saving more than double the cost of this blender on your grocery bills. With my lessons and what I teach you and how we stock the pantry, you should be cutting your food costs in half. If you're not, I want you in the Saturday morning chat this week, and I want to talk to you. I want to point out those key ways you can be cutting your grocery bills in half. No one should be spending more money on a protective diet than on a standard American diet, and everyone should be cutting their grocery bills absolutely, at least in half. Jerry and I, we eat between $70 to $100 per week for every single one of our meals. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Go ahead, Jerry.
How many seconds should a sauce be blended before it's considered blended?
Okay, on this model, there's an automatic shutoff and it's 59 seconds. That should do it, and you'll see it smooth. Now, I also have this stealth model. I use this on my demos, and because I run a test kitchen, I listen to blender all day long, and Jerry's in here working, and a lot of times he's on the phone. So we got this model, and this is a case. It's a pricier model. Now, this is my job. I do this full time. I'm running a test kitchen. So I invested in this. And you put the blender the same way, same size jar, into this unit, and it makes it silent. Well, on this one, there's a dial, so I just slide it across all the way to high. And you might have that dial on this unit, because BlendTec makes a few different units. This one has an arrow up and down. I just take it to high and let it go until it shuts off. This unit doesn't shut off on its own, so about a minute should do it, unless you loaded the blender pitcher inefficiently, where you put the liquid on top and the tofu in the bottom, or the veggies in the bottom. If you're making the guacamole and you put the spinach in the bottom, then you're not gonna get that blend as easy. When you're making your unfried beans, I want you putting the liquid in the bottom, or like I show you to drain off the canned beans and there's still enough liquid to get it going. I can put a brick of tofu in here with no liquid, and it blends itself. It blends up and onto itself. If you have the wild side jar, you might want to consider buying the four side jar or calling BlendTec and telling them, I eat a protective diet and I'm challenged because I can't blend a brick of tofu like the recipe suggests. And Julie Marie, the creator of the protective diet, is recommending your BlendTec, and I bought the wrong jar. What can you do for me? They might just send you this four-side jar. I can't guarantee it, but they are very accommodating. Or you can invest in buying another blender pitcher, the four-side jar, and use your wild-side jar for when you're making double batches of things. But this is what I use, and I can do a double batch of anything in this size jar, too. Go ahead, Jerry.
What happened, Julie, when you started getting black dust that was emitted by the jar?
Call them. They'll send you a brand new, they'll send you a whole new unit.
That happened to us, didn't it?
Yes, it did. Okay, so we're not doing a whole class on BlendTec here because I have a lot of things to show you. But I want to tell you, I always say clean as you go. So you're putting a little soap in, you're rinsing out your blender pitcher. Say you made the new cheese sauce of the week. Hopefully you'll make it, it's awesome. The broccoli and cheese sauce. So rinse out your blender pitcher, use a brush. I always have a little kitchen brush, and that's for my dishes. And I scrub that out, and I put a little soap, I run it through the blender, rinse it out. That's all it should need. Do not fill this with soapy water and leave it soaking in your sink. This is not good for the gasket. And it's not good for you, because then you have a mess to deal with after you eat dinner. Clean as you go, like I teach you in all the lessons, so that you don't have a disaster in your kitchen to clean up after yourself. And over time and practice cooking, this will become second nature to rinse this out. It's part of the blending process. We put it into our squeeze bottles or into our jars or our containers. And we're gonna go over those in the next class and the things that I recommend storing your foods in, so that it makes it really easy cleanup, great application on your meals, quick and easy. Kids love the squeeze bottles too. So, any more questions on the blender?
No, we're good.
Okay.
Clean as you go.
A central kitchen tool, a high-speed blender, either a Blendtec or a Vitamix. You go ahead and pick them. I have a video on YouTube and on Protective Diet. What's this video underneath? Where can they find it exactly, Jerry? The Blendtec video. It compares Blendtec, Vitamix, and the Ninja to each other and what the differences are and why it chose the Blendtec over the Vitamix, if you want more details.
I'm not sure. I don't.
Where are all the videos on the website?
On the video, the drop-down video.
There's a video button you can click on. It's on the drop-down menus. You can find this video in there, or you can go to Protective Diet's YouTube channel. So subscribe to that channel, and you're going to get all the new videos that I put out, all the cooking videos. You'll get notified when I add new ones, but there's days of videos. There's like 300 videos on there. Look for the blender review. That's the video.
Does your pitcher get stained even when you're using soap?
Sometimes it will stain. This is a newer pitcher, but I make my own laundry detergent, which I teach you in the Clean Up Your Cleaning Products spring cleaning class. It's a PD Ed class. And I run the laundry detergent through it, and that takes away a lot of the staining as I'm blending up my detergents. About, I'd say, every couple weeks, I make a new batch of detergent, and it cleans out my blender really well because there's baking soda in there. But if I make the red enchilada sauce that uses the dried chilies, that'll stain my blender pitcher a little bit. Certain things do, but who cares? Are you?
I just wanted a question.
Okay. Don't worry about your stained blender. That's a sign that you've been practicing a protective diet and taking good care of yourself. Okay, so the next tool I want to move on to that's totally essential is knives. So we need sharp knives. I'm wondering, okay. Sharp knife is essential. Expensive knife is not starting out. So we have two different sites, or two different knives of two different price categories that are on the website that I work with in the kitchen. And the one is the Cuisinart set. It's been available at Costco recently, but online it's actually $5 cheaper. I bought them at Costco to try them out before I would recommend them to anyone. And it comes with multiple knives. It comes with six knives. Out of that set, the ones that I use the most would be the bread or tomato knife. It's a serrated edge. It actually comes with two serrated knives. This would be the bread knife, this would be the tomato knife. It cuts through those items really nicely. And a paring knife, which is your little working knife for cutting things and peeling things. So I would say a serrated knife, a paring knife, and a chef's knife. Now this inexpensive set that's under $20, I think it's $16 or something, it comes with several chef's knives. So like these. These are not gonna be your lifetime knife. This is not gonna be something that's gonna be in 20 years fantastic. But you can sharpen them using my knife sharpening tips from my knife sharpening lesson. So you can check out that PBS class. It was all about chopping, dicing, using the right tool for the job. It was a knife class and food processing class. So we went through knife skills and also when to use the food processor versus chopping by hand. So I invested in this knife, Westhoff knife, and this one is about $100. And Costco actually carries this, but it's cheaper on with our Amazon link as well. This is an investment piece. This knife is the only knife that I use in the kitchen when I want to use a chef's knife. So those other chef's knives are kind of lonely. I use a magnetic knife for
strip.
And we have a link to that, I think, too, on the site if you're looking. But you can find those at IKEA. You can find them online. And it just holds my knives really easy and convenient right here, so I can grab them. And you know this is my prep area. I don't go far from here. And this is just a beautiful knife. Now, if you're not ready to invest in a chef's knife like this, go for that Cuisinart set or a Lorenz set, or check your discount stores like TJ Maxx and Home Goods. You can find a single knife like this that's going to be less expensive. It's not going to cut like this one does. I can guarantee that.
Tell me, why do you like that so much better than the Cuisinart?
It's got a heavier weight. It feels good, and the blade, it just cuts through. Like when some of you complain about chopping parsley, it's because your knife isn't good. If you had a really great sharp knife, you would look forward to chopping these fresh herbs. It's fun, it's exciting, it's rewarding because you're going through those herbs one time and it's just like a beautiful chop. It's clean, you're not bruising the leaves, you're cutting all the way through them. Where it, when I use this one, I have to put a little more muscle into it because it's not quite as heavy. The blade isn't quite as thin and just exact. It would be like the difference between the scissors that they cut your hair with at the salon versus scissors that you cut fabric with. They're even sharper, or scissors that you cut paper with. They're not, this would be like your typical scissors, where this is like, the edge is fine-tuned. It's just better. You're going to have a nicer experience chopping, and you're going to be a little more sure of yourself, because when you go to cut through a carrot with this, it's going to cut through it like a razor, where this one, it's not quite as sharp, so you're not going to be able to get through it so easily. So you want to keep your hands on the top of both of these always, but it's going to be a little bit actually more dangerous than this sharp one. This sharp one, they're both sharp, but this one you're gonna be able to cut your finger off with easily. It'll go right through it. So when you're working with vegetables, you're gonna be able to cut through them much easier, so there's less slips and less chance of cutting yourself. But if you did cut yourself, you'll be in trouble. When Jerry was doing his week of cooking, I had him use these knives. Because I was just scared. He still cut himself.
Still cut my finger.
But he survived. He still has his fingers. He just had to heal a little bit. So those are the knives. If anyone has any questions about knives, just bring me back to that. Now the next.
All right.
Okay.
They do have some questions. What is the title? What's that brand of knife that you were raving about?
How do I say it? Westhoff?
Westhoff.
It's a German brand knife. It's great. There's other knives on the market, Japanese knives. You can spend a lot more money than I spent on this knife, but it's wonderful. I love it. I love chopping because I have the right tool for the job, a really sharp knife. So then the next thing I want to get into is cutting boards. And a lot of you have questions like, oh, should I use a wooden cutting board, a plastic, or they call these jelly cutting boards, or these thin cutting boards. And what size cutting board do I use? I know Kim was asking about that. The key with the size of the cutting board, you want it big enough so that when you chop a big pile of parsley or cilantro, or you're cutting carrots and celery and multiple things to start a dish with or a soup with, you want it big enough so you have that work surface area. but you don't want it so big that it won't fit into your sink. So measure how big your sink is, or keep that in mind when you're at the store shopping for these, or if you order them online. We have these online. We have pretty much all the things that you see in my videos, we put a link to, so that you don't have to go searching, because I want this to be easy for you to get started. These are great starter cutting boards. I like to have multiples of these. You've seen me in videos use these to lay the pizza dough out on, so that I can easily side it onto the grill, or make corn tortillas on, so that I can easily slide it onto the grill. I use these a lot for items that I have to roll out and then transfer to cook. They're great because they slide right into the dishwasher easily. Did you have a question? Go ahead.
Do you use a honing steel to realign the blade? Not to sharpen it, just to realign it?
I don't. I actually use the back of a mug. And I show you how to sharpen a knife using that system. I have a knife sharpener as well. But I don't have, I don't use that as much. I hone it on the back of a mug is basically what I'm doing. I'm not sharpening it, I'm honing it with the ceramic unglazed area on the back of a mug. It's in that knife, I believe it's called the right tool for the job. It's a knife and food processing lesson. I'll get that number for you, but and I'll mention it in PDL. Yes?
Let me say this again. Kim is saying that her cutting boards always warp in the dishwasher.
Okay.
So should they not go in the dishwasher?
Okay. Maybe your dishwasher is running at a hotter temperature. Mine get bent if I don't keep them straight in my. I have them in a cabinet that I keep them flat and up against each other right down here, because you know this is my prep area, so I always put everything up top to do all my prep work here. My disposal's on this side, so when I have things that I need to toss out or little bits, it goes right into the sink here. Now when I use these boards, I always recommend putting a kitchen towel down and then this board on top. It gives a little more cushion for your chopping. It feels better, it's nicer on your knife, especially if you have stone surface countertops. That's hard on your knife, it's a hard surface. You want that absorption of the softness of these plastic boards or jelly boards or wooden cutting boards so that you don't dull out your knife blades. Now, if you are using those glass cutting boards, get rid of them. Those are counter protectors. Those are not cutting boards. You might see them in the store. They have like little rubber feet underneath, and it looks like a cutting board, but it sounds horrible when you're cutting into it, and it dulls your knife fast. So you want to use these plastic cutting boards or wooden cutting board to not dull that. The warping, I put them in the dishwasher just like you would a plate, and because I'm cooking a lot more than normal doing the test kitchen hours here, I use probably like three of these a day, and I just put them in there and take a fresh one, where you could just keep rinsing it and putting it on your drying rack or on a towel. You don't have to put these in the dishwasher, but I choose to. Go ahead, Jerry.
I also know that the thinner ones that we've had throughout the years, those warp really quickly.
Yeah, I have a few, like you can see these are bent. These are probably like 5 years old. And some of them...
Heck, we got one for free at a veggie factory.
Oh yeah. So I have this one. It's actually from Tamari, the company that makes Tamari. They were giving them out as a promotion. Sanjay. And they're plastic. And this I might give to a new student that I'm working with. I wouldn't use this as my regular cutting board. This is going to melt and get warped in the dishwasher. Now, if these aren't working out for you, I have to say these aren't the first thing I grab to chop on. I use these more for laying dough out or pizza out or items that I'm going to put into a stock pot. You might work with this and then use something else to cut with it, but this is my favorite one right now. I like this size for little jobs, like if I have just a little bit of parsley to chop to finish a dish, because it fits in my sink. I can rinse it off. I can wash it off really easy. This one is the largest cutting board that I would recommend for my sink. And it's just perfect. It fits in here and it's thick, so it's not gonna warp in the dishwasher, and it fits in my dishwasher and will slide in closed. It's just tall enough that I have to position it that it fits right in a certain spot to shut the bottom drawer. So these are things that you might want to think about with cutting boards, and I'm being so specific with them because it was a question that Kim was asking about and wanting to get that perfect cutting board. And I find these cutting boards at Home Goods or TJ Maxx all the time, very discounted, but you can get them through Crate and Barrel catalog, any of your houseware stores. They're going to have what they usually call as jelly boards. They're like a hard plastic that has some give to them. So that's cutting boards. I also have a wooden cutting board in here, and it's kind of awkward. It's big, it's bulky. I don't use my wooden cutting board very often. I use it for serving sometimes. I use the backside that's not all cut up, and I'll put pizza on it and chop the pizza and serve it that way. But I don't use this very often because I cut up a lot of onions and garlic and jalapenos. You know I love spicy food. So I'll put the jalapenos on here, chop them up, and then I go to something else. I can't just rinse it off. I have to really wash it to get that spice out of my cutting board. So it's just not ideal for me to work with the wooden. It feels great chopping on it. So if you want that great feeling with your awesome kitchen knife on a wooden cutting board, I totally get it. I understand. This will not go in the dishwasher. My rule in my kitchen is if it doesn't go in the dishwasher, it doesn't go in my kitchen. I don't have time to be hand washing things. So I think the only thing that I don't put in the dishwasher is my tofu press, which isn't an essential kitchen tool. We'll get to that one in the next lesson. But it's just cumbersome and I can't put it in the dishwasher. So it doesn't get utilized very often, and it's big in my kitchen. Okay, so knives and cutting boards. My next essential kitchen tool is a little gadget that I can't live without. I've traveled with this when I know I'm going to be cooking on the road or at someone's home. This is my Xylus garlic press. It's the Suzy 2. The link is on the website. Do not be confused and think the Suzy 3 is better. This one's the best one. I've had it for years and was introduced to it by the Frugal Gourmet. He was a chef on PBS when I was growing up, and this tool is just outstanding. You can put a huge clove of garlic in there, and when you do it, I don't want you peeling it. And I'm showing you this for those of you that are new to cooking. This is very important. If you've watched any of my cooking videos, chances are you've seen this garlic press and you've seen me do this, but I want to review it. So you're taking the clove right off, and when a recipe says one large clove garlic, or one large garlic clove.
One large clove garlic press.
This is a bulb of garlic. This is a clove of garlic. So you're putting it right in there with the peel on it. Do not peel this if you're pressing it. So it'll say on the recipe to press it or not. If it's going into a high-speed blender, we do not need to press it through the garlic press. So when you're pressing it, the garlic's going to come out. Get something to catch this.
Also, there's a question right now about cleaning it. Do you use the plastic cleaning?
I'm going to show you that.
Okay.
So when you're pressing it, you're putting the whole clove in there and you're pressing it out, and you're using a knife. You could use your chef's knife. I just grabbed this one. I always use these steak knives for little tools like that, or for little jobs like this. So I clear off my garlic like that, and I put it directly into what I'm cooking, or if I'm prepping my ingredients, you could do it on a little plate or on your cutting board. And then I open it, and here is my skin of my garlic, and I never have to touch it. I never have to have smelly garlic hands ever again. Did you see that? It came right off. And this, where are you gonna put this? This you're gonna put inside your veggie broth baggie, which I keep in the door of my freezer so that I can do this so easily. I'm not digging for it, and I'm putting it right in there. And that's gonna add to my broth. You can see I need to make some broth. It's attacking everything in the freezer. But it's, I keep it handy in that door. You can toss the shells out and throw a couple cloves of garlic in there too if you buy garlic in bulk like I do. And if you haven't watched the Garlic Party PDF lesson, you should watch it. Because I show you how to store garlic in your freezer, and you can buy it in bulk from Costco, save yourself a lot of money, get California grown garlic versus garlic grown in China, and just feel great about your garlic. And never have any go to waste. But, so that's how it works. I don't use that little tool that came with it to clean it out because it's perfectly cleaned out because it stays to the top here. And to get it off, you're using that knife. That way you're not wasting any of the garlic. You're not leaving anything behind. What else did I want to tell you about this? Besides,
they're all talking about how they need to try the veggie broth. Also, oh, they need to make their own veggie broth.
There's a recipe there for veggie broth. And in the notes, it talks about that VBB, the veggie broth baggie, and how you can get that started and make your own free broth. And that is the broth that you want to use and feature in the protective diet. Pho. Pronounce it right, but I say pho so you know what I'm talking about. It's spelled P-H-O. The hot and spicy Get Well Soon soup. You want to use that broth in a soup that it's really featured and it really stands out. And when, because I can never keep up with my broth needs, so I buy the box broth that's free of additives. You know the one. So, okay. Next. We're going to get into, should we just do all the little gadgets?
Yes,
a whisk. You need a whisk for your sauces, for thickening all your gravies. So pick up a whisk. It doesn't matter what kind of whisk it is. The longer handle is always better. I say metal over Teflon because the Teflon tends to lay down and get weak when you're making the mozzarella cheese. That's a heavy cheese to whip up. And maybe you're just getting started and you're like, I'm not gonna make cheese. Trust me. After you do this for 3-4 months, you're gonna see how easy these recipes are and how they're designed just so easily to flow. After you make about 30 days of recipes during your 30-day detox, you're stocking your pantry by going through all the different protective diet recipes that appeal to you. And you know, in our community, in our chats before class, in our Saturday morning live coaching hour, we talk about, in Protective Diet Living, our official support group, we talk about what recipes are easy and what were the best ones when we were first starting off. So listen up and ask the people that are masters at this, that have achieved their goals and have been doing this for years. Ask them what are the easiest recipes and what are their go-to, you know, 15-minute prep recipes when you're just getting started. It's really going to help you out. And ask me. I'm your number one proactive partner. So reach out to me in those chat times and I'll help you along with that. But you need a whisk and you'll be making cheese, I have a feeling, in no time. So a vegetable brush. If you're very new to cooking, maybe you didn't realize how you really wash off potatoes. Sometimes potatoes are so beautifully clean, like your yellow, your Yukon Golds or your red potatoes. Sweet potatoes generally are washed really clean when they're coming to you. But those Idaho Baker potatoes, those big potatoes.
That russet, I think is what
they're russet. Called. Those potatoes are, they're a lot of times they're really dirty. So you're gonna use this brush, you're gonna run it under some water or you can fill a bowl of water and just scrub it off with your vegetable brush. Have a separate brush for your pitcher, for your blender pitcher, or your kitchen dishes. I always use this to wash my dishes, to save my hands, to save my manicure, and keep my hands out of the soapy water. So I use a brush to rinse off my dishes and wash them up, and then put them into the dishwasher, or you could wash them completely. This is your vegetable brush, this is your dish brush. Like we talk about in the kitchen systems class, if you live with multiple people, roommates, partners, family, kids, tell them, this is the veggie brush and this is the sink brush. Get two different colors. Then they won't be mixing them up and they won't be cleaning potatoes with a brush that maybe was put down the garbage disposal and not so clean.
Right.
Then we have the microplane grater. And this is used to grade your ginger. Where do we keep our ginger? We always buy our ginger fresh and we store it in our refrigerator door in a baggie or a container. and it's so easy to grate it frozen. It grates beautifully frozen, and we don't have this dried up little ginger root. Ginger's a root. If a recipe calls for ginger, it is always fresh ginger, unless it states ground ginger. There's very few recipes that I use ground powdered ginger in. It's more than likely, if it just says ginger, it'll show you to grate it. It will give you those exact directions so you'd know it was fresh. You would never grate a dried powdered spice. And I'm saying this because we have a large community of very new to cooking students. So I want to go through the details and remind you, in all the recipes, I would never leave you guessing. So if something tells you to place tofu in the blender, that doesn't mean you press it. I would say to press it. I get that question quite often. If it says to use ginger, it's going to tell you to grate it finely, or on your microplane grater. Those green links on all the recipes, if you click on it, you're going to see this grater. It's to help you to know the action step, to know what you're doing. So when we grate ginger,
you
can see, I don't peel my ginger before I grate it. Is that what you're going to ask?
Yeah, that was another question. Yeah.
I don't peel it because the peel usually stays on the top. You can. Now, if you want to peel your ginger, just take a spoon and run it down the root of the ginger. Hopefully you can see this. And the peel just peels right off. It's like lickety split. But I don't even bother. I'm so fortunate where I live now that I can buy ginger in bulk from Costco, and it's organic. So I feel fine with the peel. The peel is such a fine peel that it's not something that's going to be bothersome in the recipes that I do when I use the microplane, because it grates it up. Now, if a big piece comes off on the front of the microplane grater as I'm grating it, I toss this out. You could put it in your veggie broth baggie. Or eat it. No, I don't eat the ginger peel. That's one thing I don't eat while I cook, but I do a lot of snacking while cooking. Thanks for telling everyone, Jerry. I've been working on that. I'm a snacker while I cook. It's a bad habit, and then I sit down to dinner and sometimes I'm not even hungry. Okay, so the microplane grater. And with that one, I never put that in the dishwasher. Same with the knives. I want to go over that little tip. Don't put your sharp knives in the dishwasher, because hot water dulls implements. It also dulls your microplane, and you want this super sharp so that it's fast and easy to make your Asian style kale or your broccoli and garlic sauce. Those are quick recipes. And when you have the tools for the job to do them, the right tool for the job, it makes it so rewarding and so easy. And there's just very few tools, kitchen essential tools for a protective diet. And you're seeing them all today. This is a reamer. You can use it to do a lemon. So these are just some basic techniques I'm showing you, because we have a lot of new to the kitchen students. And most of you know what I'm talking about when I'm asking you to use 2 tablespoons of lemon. It's usually half a lemon. These are a little bit small. I might need a little more. But this tool is used just like this. You're going to go around and you can collect the seeds. There's also juicers that are in a glass dish that, if you're on a real tight budget, go to Goodwill. You're going to find one there. They always have them. They're a glass dish, and it's a little bowl, and it has this in the center of it. So you can ream your lemon like this, get the juice out of it. It flows down into the bowl, and you can pick your seeds out, and it usually has a pour spout. Those are great, too, and they're usually glass. They can go right into the dishwasher. This goes into my silverware holder in my dishwasher just fine. Go ahead, Jerry.
They're asking if the countertop is stainless steel, as if the basin of the sink is stainless steel.
This counter?
Yes.
It looks like steel?
That's what
No, this is a quartz countertop. Quartz is half, man-made half natural stone. It's a very hard countertop. It's newer. It's become very popular just recently in the past 5 years or so. It's like the new thing. But stainless steel would be kind of cool, but very fingerprinty, like the refrigerators and the sinks and stuff. So, okay, so here's your juice. When you're using 2 tablespoons of lemon juice or 4 tablespoons of lemon juice, which in my recipes it usually goes 2 tablespoons or 4 tablespoons, you're going to measure these with your measuring spoon. So I keep my measuring spoons out on a jar on my counter in my prep area, so it's really convenient. And you've seen that in the kitchen setup class. If you haven't watched that, check it out. It just makes things easier for you. Once you get through these lessons, you're gonna be like, oh, I set up my kitchen and this is really, everything flows. And you get through your job faster of cooking. So you want to measure out exactly 2 tablespoons in a recipe. Don't just guess. Unless you've been cooking a while and you know what you're a little more comfortable and you've made that recipe before and it turned out. I keep 2 sets of measuring spoons in this little container so that if I use a wet ingredient like I just did, and then I find out I need a dry ingredient and I have to scoop into it with the same size, I don't have to go and dry it off or rinse it. Now, in my recipes, I have them designed where I start with dry ingredients, then I move to wet, so you're never having to deal with that. But you might be doing your setup Sunday where we make all our sauces and condiments and set ourselves up for the week, and you're making maybe 3 or 4 different dressings or sauces or dips, and then you need that second set so that nothing slows you down. So you can use it and just toss it in the dishwasher, or use it and rinse it is what I usually do. I rinse as I go, I clean as I go. But 2 sets are good for me because I'm doing a lot more cooking than the average person, like I said before, with the test kitchen. But it's kind of nice. If you're just getting started, 1 set is just perfectly fine. Then I want to move on to measuring cups. So they come in a set, so it's not like you have to go searching for them. Unless you're at Goodwill, which I think I got these from a thrift store many years ago.
So.
And I bought several sets of stainless steel measuring cups at thrift stores. It's a great place to search for these kitchen essentials. They're very common tools. I have 4 sets of these because of the test kitchen situation. Really, you need 1 to 2. If you're cooking with your kids, get 2 sets of them so that they can cook with you and help you. And it's a lot easier if you have to go, if you're making multiple recipes, like I said, and you're digging into dry ingredients and then into moist, and then your containers are all wet, you can't go back and measure dry ingredients unless you dry everything off, and then it's gonna slow you down. So then we have our water spray bottle. This came from the Dollar Tree. It's a fine mist water spray bottle. I use this to spray my chips and salt them. I salt them first, and then I give them a fine mist, about that much, on the tray of chips so that the salt melts and sticks. I don't spray and then salt, because by the time I get around to salting, the spray has dried and my salt won't stick. If you're totally salt-free, you probably won't need this, but we do use this sprayer when we make the croutons, when we're getting other herbs and garlic powder and things like that to stick to the croutons, we use the spray bottle. So this is something I would keep around, and when I use it, I empty it out of water every time I use it. It's like you want to keep that water fresh, and I spray out all the water that's in the tube. And I actually put it in here so that it drains, because I don't want that water sitting in there. If I don't use it for several days, I'm not baking chips every day, although Jerry would be happy if I was.
Oh, yes.
So, and I have a salt shaker. You don't have to have a salt shaker. You might use a salt pig, which is what this is. And you can measure easily. If you're using salt in your recipes, you can easily dig in and measure. And I love this. It's convenient. This was actually made by my brother's friend. We call her the Mad Potter. She's into pottery, so she made that. But those are available too. They're very common, very popular.
Julie?
Yes.
Do you spray the popcorn so that the spices can stick to it?
Yes.
I like just sea salt on my popcorn. I don't like anything else. So does Jerry. Marcy turned me on to it at a party. We still like have the hardest time like finding popcorn seasonings to be good.
Remember when you used to put vinegar on it?
I used to put apple cider vinegar in a spray bottle and Jerry couldn't stand the smell of it. It was gross to him. It was like a salt replacement.
It was her way of eating all the popcorn. That's what it was. So yeah. I wouldn't touch it.
He didn't like it. So I really like just salt. And I buy multicolored popcorn. This is my little trick, especially because we feed a lot of people that aren't on a protective diet when they come over because we want to turn them on to it, right? All of our friends and family and new neighbors that we've met, people at the pool, we're always bringing popcorn to the pool because it's so quick and easy to make. And man, when there's nothing, no snacks there, people think, you'd think our popcorn was loaded with butter or something because everyone loves it, everyone eats it. So this is a multicolored corn that we order through our co-op, but you can find it online if they don't have it at your local grocery store. But the multicolored corn, it has yellow and white and like some different variations of corn after it's popped. So it looks like it's been buttered because of the golden colored corn that, because it looks gold next to the white corn. And it's non-GMO because it's organic, it's fantastic, great snack, cheap, quick. But I spray it with water pretty liberally, and then I spray it, and then I give it a little salt, and I spray it again. And as we eat through it, then we do the next layer when we notice there's no taste to it. Now, people are like, oh, my popcorn gets all soggy. Well, I remember quite clearly when I poured butter on my popcorn, it all shriveled up, and that was the good popcorn that you looked for in the bowl. So I call this my butter, and when Jerry and I eat popcorn, he's always like, can you put some more butter on here? And I use a spray bottle.
Extra
butter, please. And we spray it. Now this little bit of shaker of salt that you're putting on your popcorn, if you're just transitioning to a whole food plant-based diet and you were eating microwave popcorn before, this is like such a trace amount of salt compared to what we were eating previously. You are going to produce beautiful results. Your blood pressure is going to lower. You're going to see changes all around. Do not fear a little bit of salt during your transition. This is not going to be your holdup. The fat, the oil, the sugar, the food additives, that's going to set you back. This is not going to be a setback, believe me. We wouldn't have the success stories we have in the community if salting and putting extra butter, PD butter, your water spray bottle on your popcorn, we wouldn't be producing these kind of results. Use the salt. Make your food satisfying. That's what makes this sustainable. Okay, so then we're gonna move on to, let's do baking pans and then we'll do the cookware. So, there's two sizes of, this is a rimmed baking sheet. That's what it's labeled on my recipes. It's a baking sheet with a rim. See? So there's two sizes. This is a full-size sheet pan. You want to measure your oven before you order these or go to the store looking for them. TJ Maxx Home Goods has these. We also have links for them online. This one fits my whole rack, and in my oven I have two racks. So I make a lot of Fiesta layer dip. You've seen pictures. Jerry and I love to eat that every Tuesday night after class. Usually that's what we have for dinner because it's fast. We bake two sheets of chips while I'm preparing the layer dip. And then when the layer dip goes into the oven, I bake another sheet with a half sheet. And because I make my layer dip in my pie plate, and this fits perfectly together in the oven, so I can get another sheet and a half of chips with my layer dip, and I've already made two sheets, and that fills Jerry and I. That's our whole dinner right there. So I would recommend getting a half sheet pan, just one, because you might want to use it with your Fiesta layer dip, or on Thanksgiving when you're baking multiple things, you might need a smaller pan so you can fit another one next to it. And then for these, I recommend having four full-sized sheet pans like this. I have even more than that, but four is good because if you're making baked tortilla chips like Jerry and I make them, you're gonna lay out two pans. And while those are in the oven baking, you lay out two more pans and then you swap them out. You're not waiting and wasting time taking the hot chips out and then re-layering up. Time efficiency is key. We don't wanna spend our life in the kitchen. We wanna take all this energy that we're getting from our food and have fun with it. We don't wanna waste our time. So get four of these. Go ahead, Jerry.
Would you, in the chat, they're talking about how when they made popcorn with oil, they would season the popcorn and then shake it again after they've seasoned it.
Don't shake your bowl. You're gonna lose your seasoning.
That's what I was thinking, but yeah.
So I do it in layers. So you have your bowl of popcorn, and you're going, I knew they'd get held up on the food, on the popcorn.
Well, talking of course, it's important.
Popcorn is so delicious, and it's so easy, and it's so cheap, and we can get it organic, and we can get it, you know, online, delivered straight to our door. We buy it in a 25-pound bag. I'll show you.
Right quick, while you're getting that, are those bowls stainless steel or are they aluminum?
They're stainless steel bowls, and I'll have them the rest of my life. This is how we get our popcorn in 25-pound bags. And then I fill my container so it's quick and easy. So if you have kids, especially like 10-year-olds, that need to be able to make their own snack after school, this is perfect. But be sure to pour it into a container that they can reach and they can scoop and they know how to measure it for their popcorn maker. Now, if you don't have an air popper, you can do this. I'm just gonna put this down here so I can fill it. If you don't have an air popper, which we're gonna talk about that in the next lesson when we talk about kitchen gadgets that are helpful, you can air pop your popcorn on the stove. Like, you just put a quarter cup in there and turn the heat up. Put it on like medium and shake the pan just like my mom used to do, but she put oil in the bottom. Keep it moving. When you hear it stopping popping, take it off the heat so it doesn't burn. And it's just really simple. You don't have to have an air popper, but if you have kids, get an air popper. It's about $15 to $18. It's such a great solution for snacks.
Explain the difference in taste for the multicolored compared to just the plain.
Not much difference in taste. There's different size corns and different colors. So not much difference in taste. It's just the visual appeal is there because it's yellow and white and there's different colors and it makes it look like it's buttered popcorn. When I put it in a beautiful bowl and I take it to the pool and if we have friends there with us, they're like, oh. If it was just white, I don't think it would have as much appeal. Doesn't it look like it's buttered?
Right, it does. Yes. And the flavor, I guess, probably comes because we're buying organic corn. Is that why?
I think the flavor of any popcorn's great. Get what you can afford. And the amount that we order it in, we order it in bulk. We save so much on it. And we're not buying bag chips that are $5 a bag anymore. We're buying popcorn, and that's our go-to snack all the time. It's just delicious and it's great for us and it's good starch energy and it's high fiber. There's so much good about it. Don't fear all corn and don't be fearful of, you know, your regular popcorn that you buy in the grocery store that's not organic. Trader Joe's, if you have one of those near you, they have a great deal on organic popcorn in little bags. We just go through so much of it that I don't buy it in little bags anymore. Go ahead, Jerry.
Angela from Colorado was saying that it does taste, or does look a lot like buttered popcorn.
Oh, she does buy that too.
She does buy the molded color too.
Yeah, and there's blue corn, and that's kind of cool, but it doesn't pop blue. Just the kernel looks blue. It does have a tone of red corn. There's Amish corn that you can find online. I don't know if it's organic though.
Our baking pans, are those stainless steel or aluminum?
These are stainless steel. And some are coated with a non-stick coating, or I don't know exactly what the material is, but these I scrub with, you know, my paste that I make in the clean up your cleaning products spring cleaning lesson. I use that paste that I show you how to make to clean them really good if I don't line them. But I usually always line them with either a silicone mat, get a pack of these, You can order these online or get them at pretty much any big box store. Costco carries them sometimes during the holidays, I believe. Mine are actually, I need to replace them. They're worn out. The non-stick coating to them is gone, so I'm looking for a deal on them. Been shopping around.
We have them on our website.
I just need to order them. And then parchment paper. If you're just getting started and you don't want to get into the silicone mats, this is a great solution. I use the one from Costco. It's the best value. There's We Care brand. Do not buy the dollar store parchment paper. I don't know what they're making out of. I've heard some parchment papers, they use Teflon in it to make it nonstick, which isn't great for us. I would avoid that. But the dollar store parchment paper, when I make fries on it, they all stick. So don't mess with that. It's not a saving.
What would you say if they had aluminum baking pans? What would you recommend?
You're going to line them, so that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, if you already have baking pans, it's fine. These are, if you're just getting started in your kitchen, get these rimmed heavyweight ones. They heat up really nice. They like the flat sheet, cookie sheets, they're called. They don't have a rim on them. I don't appreciate those as much because if I'm making like a pan of chips on here and Jerry takes them out of the oven and he's not paying attention, he might lose them. They slide off. There's also ceramic coated baking pans, which are fantastic. If you're new in the market, buy the ceramic coating. It's really slippery. I haven't found any that are rimmed, so I haven't gotten into them yet. But those are beautiful.
Do you think the potatoes brown better on parchment paper or directly on the pan?
Parchment. Always parchment paper. Okay. Parchment paper is our secret to browning everything oil-free. And if you make those speedy steak fries or the grilled steak fries recipe, oh my gosh, those are the best. Make those over all the other fries that are on the site. Those are the best recipe. You're going to get these golden crispy fries, and you can crinkle cut them. You can do them however you want. Circles, sticks. Go ahead, Jerry.
Teresa from Minnesota is asking, can you share the tip about crinkling up the parchment paper?
Oh, perfect. Awesome. Thank you, Teresa. Okay, so when you're laying it out on your baking sheet, I should have probably mentioned this too. For new cooks that are new to using parchment paper, you'd probably use this over the silicone mat. Parchment paper is different than wax paper. You want to make sure it says parchment paper. And this one's a vegetable-based parchment paper. There's all different ones, but that's the one that I use. If you have a Costco, it comes in a two-pack. It's a great value. So you're going to fold it like this, up, and then flip it over so that it fits perfectly. And if it doesn't fit, if your pan is longer on this, if it's shorter, you just fold it. You're going to fold it down and then fold it this way and then flip it over so you have that smooth surface. That would be if your pan was shorter on this side too. So all your crazy business is underneath and you have this smooth surface to lay your potatoes or your whatever you're making, your pizzas, you're pressing them out. But as you do this a little while, you'll start to realize I can really save waste and not be using this paper so frequently and use these. And when I use these, I wash them in the pan that I use them in. So I would put them in this pan and I would add a little bit of soap to this. And then if they're stuck on stuff, and then I fill the pan while I'm eating my dinner and I leave it sit there. You could even move it to a counter if you need your sink to do other things. Leave it sit there. And then I come back with my scrub brush. I brush it off and then I rinse it. And then I give it a little shake. And this is the system that we've come up with. Now we don't have a stainless steel top stove, so it's okay if water gets on it and spots it up a little. But we have these little clips with magnets on them. And I just...
They're also on our website, I think.
I just do that, or I put them under here and hang them. I think my magnet got wet. I put it under here and hang them so that they drip dry, because it's always kind of an awkward thing. I don't want to spend time drying my silicone mats. So this is how we do it.
Also, putting them there over the stove
If the oven was still hot, it's like while we're eating dinner or after dinner, right. They just dry really quick. So that's just a little trick. So then when I wash these out, I just rinse them out.
Do your potatoes brown on the silicone mats?
Yes.
Marlissa is saying that
hers are very brown. The bottom of the potato is brown. So check the bottoms. When we make the cheater baked potatoes, you're putting the cut side down and you're gonna lift it and it's gonna be golden brown. I posted pictures of those with the broccoli and cheese sauce today in Protective Diet Living. You should check it out. The French fries on parchment or the silicone mats get beautifully browned on the underside. So that's the side you're gonna lift up and present if you're serving it to someone. The top sides don't get as golden. It's whatever's touching the silicone or the parchment. Okay, then we're gonna move on to, we only have a few things left. Okay, this is my number one pan to cook in. 5.5 quarts. This, I make my tomato cream sauce. It'll toss a pound of pasta into it. I can make my plant-based etouffee in here. Everything fits perfectly. My bolognese sauce, it's awesome. If you're in the market for a pan, and it's gonna be your everyday pan, I can fit 1.5 pounds of baby kale from Costco that I chop and put in here, or my Asian-style kale, in one pot. And then I toss 2 cups of cooked rice, 2 cups dried, cooked, and I perfectly cooked rice, use that recipe in your pressure cooker or on your stovetop, and I mix it in. This pan, I can't live without it. It's my everyday pan. And this is on the website. It's a Cuisinart 5.5 casserole. You can make your roastless pot roast in here and put it in the oven. This is going to be a really, really efficient kitchen tool. You're gonna use it a lot. Then I have this is a 4-quart pot for pasta. Now you can get littler pans and stuff to make sauces with, but these two are essential. If you're gonna cook your pasta in here, you can cook your rice in here, your quinoa in here, if you're doing stovetop, if you haven't invested in a pressure cooker yet. All of my pressure cooker recipes, there's an option to either use a slow cooker or stovetop method. You don't have to have a pressure cooker, although it will make your life fabulous. And I have both the Sakura and the Instant Pot, and we're gonna go over those tools in the next lesson because they're not essential, although after you get your BlendTec, you wanna get one of these. And usually by the 3rd or the 4th month, you're gonna have plenty left over funds from saving eating a protective diet to invest in those. Then I want to talk about strainers. I use a mesh strainer to rinse dried beans, to rinse lentils. When I'm talking about straining beans or lentils or fine things, quinoa if you wanted to rinse it, although most quinoa is not treated, or it's tumbled, it removes the chemical that makes it bitter. It's a natural chemical on it. This would be what you would use, this fine mesh strainer. I strain my pasta in here. You want a strainer with handles to make it easy. Steamer basket. I use this a lot. I use it in my pressure cooker when I cook potatoes and different things. And there's several recipes that we use this. And then on the stovetop, it goes in your pot. We use it when we make tamales. We use it when we cook vegetables, you just want to steam up some broccoli or asparagus, you're using a steamer basket. Very inexpensive kitchen tool, and you're putting the water in the bottom, and every recipe that uses this will give you the directions to put the water at the bottom. Then we have, we're good over here. So these are mixing bowls. I have 2 sizes. When I'm baking, if I'm using a flour and a moist ingredient, this is what I'm using. If I'm washing my herbs for my herb storage box, if you haven't watched that video, it's on the bottom of every website page on protectivediet.com to store your herbs in the refrigerator in an herb box. It's just a box, an average box, but I show you how to do it. Watch that video. I use this to wash out my herbs. If you don't have a salad spinner yet, this is what you're gonna wash your lettuce in. And then you're gonna put it out on a towel to dry. Eventually you'll get your salad spinner, but you don't need it, it's not essential. These two are essential. They don't have to be stainless steel, they can be plastic bowls from the dollar store. But about this size is gonna do you really well. I toss my salads in here with the dressing and then I put them into the bowls that I serve them in. Tossed salads are always better than salads you pour dressing directly on top of. And then we're down to baking pans. We have hot mitts. You need two hot mitts. Very important. If you're just getting into cooking, you might not have them and you're using towels. Don't ever go to take something out of the oven with a wet kitchen towel. The wetness in the towel,
it's a conductor.
It's a conductor of heat, and you won't feel it right away until that pan's in your hand, and that pan's gonna hit the floor if you're cooking something at 450 degrees, believe me. So hot mitts are very important, and keep them dry. Your glass pie plate, get one of these, pick one up. Go to your local Goodwill store if you're on a tight budget. They're very inexpensive at any big box store or online. We have a link for it with Amazon. We make all our pies in here. We can make our brownies in here, which brings me back to this. Either a brownie pan, when I'm talking about a brownie pan or a square baking pan for brownies, that's this. You could make your apple pie in this, no problem. This one's coated with ceramic coating. You could have a non-stick one, whatever. You can line it with parchment paper. So I'm going to show you how to line this with parchment paper. But this we use for the Fiesta layer dip. We use it for many things. The tamale pie, you're going to use a pie plate a lot in protective diet recipes. So pick one up. It's an essential to consider. So crumple up your piece of parchment paper, and this is going to make it more pliable and lay out beautifully. So have your kids help you do this. It's fun, it's exciting, tell them why, and you're teaching them a life lesson and how to cook, a way for them to avoid the challenges you went through with your health in their future. So because we crumpled it up like this, I'm gonna line the baking sheet, because I usually line the baking sheet, my glass pie plate, nothing sticks to. It's really great to bake in.
Do you prefer ceramic over silicone?
Yes. The new ceramic pans, we're gonna get into that with the muffin pans. I know I'm running a little bit over my hour, but too bad. These are very essential kitchen tools, Jerry. Just hold on to your horses there. So you can see it holds the shape of the pan once you've crumpled it and then put it in. And show your kids how to do this. They can be your pan liners. They'll be so excited that you're making them brownies or you're making them fudge, PB fudge. Just don't tell them it's good for them. And then we have one other pan that I didn't put down. And that is the loaf pan. If you want to get into making banana bread, lasagna, I do in here, especially if you're single, make the classic lasagna recipe. And the same thing, when you're making the banana bread, crumple up your paper and you can line this. And it's like no cleanup then, and it's not gonna stick. So, and you'll have this for a lifetime. If you want the glass one, and you'll find this probably at your local thrift store, Goodwill, if you're on. So then we have the muffin pans. Now, if you have muffin pans already, use those and use the We Care brand liners. They're parchment paper lined liners. We have a link for those on the website under Kitchen Tools. And if you're in the market for muffin pans, get the ceramic coated ones. We have links for these. This is a regular size and this is the mini muffin pans. You can use either one. The recipes are designed for the larger ones, but you can get creative if you want to make mini muffins. These, I love them. They clean up beautifully and they're super slick and they're just fantastic. So are there any questions coming through?
Why do you crumple the papers?
You crumple the paper to make it lay into place and stay into place. If you just ripped off a sheet of parchment paper and tried to put it in here, it won't stay in there. And then you want to pour your batter for your banana bread, your banana health bread. If you haven't tried that recipe, go for it. It's so good. And I know in the student files, people have variations of adding chocolate to it. Gisela, she gave us some, and it was just, it was awesome. We had it yesterday for our travel back from Chicago. But you can see it doesn't stay in place. When you crumple it and roll it back out, it's going to stay perfectly in place. It's just a little trick. You don't have to do it, but it makes it easier to pour your batter into it stays in place.
Okay, she got it.
So those are all of our essential kitchen tools. And the next lesson I'm going to do, I'm going to go over the tools that make it even easier that you want to add to these or replace these with. I actually replaced this with this unit. I'll show it to you next class. It's an electric juicer because we use a lot of lemon juice in many of the sauces, dips, and dressings and recipes. So this might get a little bit cumbersome. Now I'm making a lot more and testing a lot more, so I use the electric one. It's not essential, but it makes things easy for me because I make these recipes over and over again, as you'll find yourself. You'll find your about your 10 favorites, and you'll cycle through those. Make notes of your family's favorites, your kids' favorites, and keep repeating them. Keep them in the rotation. If they say, Mom or Dad, I love this one, make a note of it. Feed them what they like. Have them select through the pictures on the website so they can pick and choose what's going to be for dinner, because then they're going to eat it. Include them in the cooking process because then they're going to eat it. They're invested in it. They're excited. They made it. They're proud of it. They're going to give it a taste.
We got people from California, Colorado, Canada, all over the place. Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, all over the place, saying this is a great class. I want to say good job, Julie.
Well, thank you so much. Thanks for tuning in live.
Thanks for all the questions, too.
And if you're catching this in the archives, keep doing what you're doing. Make this week the healthiest week. Make the best choices you can. And reach out for support. We're there 24 hours in Protective Diet Living to lift you up, to encourage you, to show you the way. There's so many masters in that group. Follow their lead. Get a proactive partner in there, someone that's already done it, so that they can show you, you can do this. You can do this just like I did it. So take care, everyone. Best of health. I wish you all the best.
See you, everyone.